All right, this is August 24th, 1996. Our survivor is Helen Colin. We are in Houston, Texas, in the United States. The interviewer is Pamela Lane. The interview will be conducted in English. My name is Pamela Lane, L-A-N-E, and today we're going to be interviewing Helen Colin. The interview is in English, which is taking place in Houston, Texas, in the United States, and the date is August 24th, 1996. All right. Could you tell us your name and spell it for us, please?
Helen, H-E-L-E-N, last name C-O-L-I-N.
And what was your name at birth?
Hella, H-E-L-A, G-O-L-D, S-T-E-I-N, Goldstein.
And have you ever used any other names?
No, ma'am.
What is your date of birth?
April 15th, 1923.
And your current age?
73.
And what is the city and the country of your birth?
I was born in Lodz, L-O-D-Z, Poland, P-O-L-A-N-D, Poland.
All right, Helen, we're going to go back now to some of your earliest memories. And I'd like to talk about life in Lodz, what that was like, what you remember of it. Let's start with your family. First of all, what is your father's name?
Yosef, Joseph.
And what did he do for a living?
He was a builder, and he did a lot of, he was self-employed, did a lot of things on his own, build, primarily in the building business.
What kind of a man was he?
My father was more like a friend to us. Any time that he had a little time, he would play with all of us, and I vividly remember one particular Sunday or Saturday that he took us on sleigh rides and up in the mountains, and we followed it. Daddy dragged the sleigh, and we four children followed him up the mountain, and then he would sit down first, and we would sit in the back so he can kind of hold the wind, the breeze from us, the cold, and then we came down, and we did that repeatedly, and it was so much fun. He was very, very anxious to always come to different classes to see our achievements. He was busy with the children. That was his life. He wanted to see the children grow up to be productive, intelligent, and self-reliant. That was their goal, mother and daddy.
What was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Miriam.
And did your mother work?
No, mother was a homemaker, and mother was my confidant, my closest friend. I didn't need anybody other than my mother. When my mother said something, it was I didn't need anyone to okay it, because I knew it's true, and I knew it's right. And it was like God had spoken. When my mother spoke to me, or to any of the other children for that matter. She's very close with us, very close. Always managed to, in different, at different times of the year, you know, at schools, different classes, because I have a sister that's older, and she would come and help us produce a play pertaining to the holiday that we are celebrating, being Hanukkah or coming up, Rosh Hashanah or Yom Kippur or anything like that, she would want it always to show the other children, the non-Jewish children, what we are celebrating. And for Passover, you know, we had to put on a, for every holiday, we put on a play. And with the original table settings and the true ceremonial occasion. And it was fun, it was really fun. And even the non-Jewish children really enjoyed. They were very interested in it. And mother was the one that always instigated that play for every different holiday. So we produced it, I remember, in our house. Sometimes the weather permitting, we were in the backyard in the garden, and we had a little gazebo, and we played the last dress rehearsal we did in the gazebo, and mother was sitting and watching, and she still had some corrections to make, which we appreciated, you know, because she knew better than us.
Tell me about the school you went to.
I went to a co-ed school, and it was a mixture of Jewish and non-Jewish children, as I mentioned before, and boys and girls. And growing up, being that my father was in the profession he was in, we were exposed to a lot of different affairs, such as christening in a church, which we attended. We were dressed like for a great holiday, like for a party, gloves and all, no matter how young we were, and little hats, and we paraded into being a church or somewhere in the house, and we watched the christening or a wedding, not necessarily Jewish, and we were exposed to all of that. And so it didn't make any difference, because there were friends, neighbors that we grew up together, that we cherished.
Did you ever experience any anti-Semitism as a child?
Yes, unfortunately it was very often at a moment of anger or rage or unhappiness that somebody experienced, they would call me or any one of the of my friends, "You dirty Jew."
Could you describe that, kind of how that would happen? Would these be adults or other children?
Well, unfortunately, the adults, we would come home and we would complain. We would say, "Why did they call us dirty Jews? We are dressed nice, we are clean. Why did they do that? Why?" And it was lack of belief that people can be cruel to others, that my parents, as well as many other parents and grandparents, didn't react. They just said, "Oh, this is children, you know." But it happened with adults too, that they were, you know, they were not invited to different affairs. Like my father was very, very well known in the like the White House, the City Hall. And there were sometimes some affairs that father was not invited because he was Jewish. And I could hear a whisper between daddy and mother about not being invited. His feelings were hurt, but he says, "Not all of them are like that." And so consequently, they tried to brush it off as not being important. But how well do we know now how important it was to react and act immediately. That was unfortunately not done by our parents, as I say, our grandparents, which we have, aunts and uncles, numerous cousins. Nobody reacted to, we just assumed it's ignorance on their part that they call us that way, but that wasn't the case. As it turned out, it was not the case.
Could you describe your home for us?
I had a very warm home, not a big home, but very warm. I remember in one of the corners in a bedroom, my mother's bouquet, bridal bouquet, dried flowers wrapped in chiffon so the dust doesn't touch it. It was hanging in the corner right above the bed, right on the side of the bed in the bedroom. And I always admired it so much because it was, to me at that time, it was a huge bouquet. It was a bridal bouquet. The house was very, always received with everybody that walked in was welcome with open arms. My mother was a person that liked to entertain. It didn't matter who. It didn't matter even if a health inspector came through and he passed by, she would invite him in and say, "We have something you haven't eaten in a long time. I want you to sit down and take a break and taste it." So that was one of the things. Another thing I remember, Daddy being very, very well respected in the community. Whenever they had a dispute, two Jewish people had a business dispute or something, they didn't resort to going to a lawyer or a court. This was a no-no. They would call my father, and my father was the judge and the jury. So I remember whenever they would come into the house, my mother would prepare the dining room table. The doors were closed. Nobody walked in, not even my mother. And Daddy conducted this affair to the best of his ability. Many times he succeeded, and many times he didn't. And when he didn't, he was very disappointed. He tried to contact them the following days and still talk about it. We will never know what the dispute was about because he wasn't about to tell us. He, not even his wife, I don't think so, but because this was very personal. And mother only prepared a table so they have refreshments and drinks and whatnot, and perhaps a celebration after the outcome.
Tell us about your brothers and sisters.
I have an older sister that survived. She is 3 years older than I. And I had only one brother. And he was 14 years old when I lost him in Auschwitz. And I had a little sister that was 9. And she went with my mother in Auschwitz. She was separated from my mother and I and my sister. And as a young person, not productive, not being able to work, they put her on one side and the elder people on the same side. And the younger, being that my mother was only 44 years old, and she was very young, she almost looked like my sister. They pushed her on the side where I was, and my sister, my older sister. And then my little sister turned around, my youngest one, and a 9-year-old, and she says, "Mommy, Mommy, Helen, that's me, and Steph, I will take care of themselves, they're big girls. Mommy, come with me." So she turned around and she went. We were so shocked, we didn't know where we were. Had we known what is expect, what can we, what the outcome will be, we would have perhaps saved our mother and sacrificed our little sister. But we didn't know. We didn't believe it.
Let's go back before the war. Tell me what your sisters and your brothers' names were, and tell me what it was like for all of you as a family before. What were their likes? What did they enjoy doing before the war?
My older sister was a bookworm. She loved books. She loved schooling. She loved. Had the war not come, I'm convinced that she probably would have been a doctor, because she was very, very interested in medicine. And anybody in the family that had, I was afraid of blood. If I cut myself, I couldn't see it. She had to come over and clean it up and do it for me, because she knew better. And I kind of followed her around like a little puppy, because I was 3 years younger and she was the example of the family. I wasn't as good in school as she was, but I passed. I managed to pass. I like fun. My younger...
What was her name?
Her name was Steffa. Is Steffa. Thank God she is alive. S-T-E-F-A. And my younger brother, the only brother, was like a gift to us. He kind of, when we had a little argument, me and my older sister, because she wanted the bike and we only had one bike, and I wanted the bike, he would come and straighten it out. And he would be the referee. Always kind of, I very rarely remember him being a real child. He was always kind of like an adult, short in size, very short boy, but good, a heart of gold. He would give away later on in the ghetto. We could see what that young man was.
How much younger than you was he?
He was 4 years younger. And then it was my, and his name, R-O-M-E-K. He was just a total jewel of a boy. He never got angry. He never really was upset with anybody. An extremely obedient mother and daddy, when they spoke, I mean, there was never a question. There was never, I don't want to do it. I'm going to, mother said and daddy said, and that was life then. And I remember so very well when one time he came home and it was past dinner time, and mother says, my goodness, I was so concerned, I was so worried. Where were you? What happened to you? He says, well, I went to say hello to this neighbor, and she gave me cookies, and I went to the other neighbor, and she baked cake. It was so good. And so we sat down for dinner, and he couldn't eat, because he had cookies and cake. Because they all adore him. He was really a lovable young man. That's one of the few people that I really wished he was alive. It's hard to think about it, because I see him right in front of me. I see his face. I see his gestures. That's the only memory I have, the only thing I have. No pictures. Sad.
And your little sister?
My little sister was 9 years old.
So she was 5 years younger than he?
Yes. She came as a surprise. And I remember my mother was very, very disappointed when she found out that she's going to have another child. She says, 3 years enough. It should have been enough. Why didn't we take care of it? And she had a conversation with Daddy, and I recall the conversation so vividly, because he says, well, don't worry, darling, don't worry. When you're on the pillow, your head is on the pillow delivering the baby, it'll be filled with money, not with down, with money. So you will not ever have to worry about that child. And that kind of, you know, calmed her, because at that time, it wasn't like you're going to go and have a abortion. Although we had a neighbor, a cousin of ours, that was a gynecologist, and she discussed many evenings with him the situation that it's so late in life that she shouldn't have a child. And he says, each child is bringing its own luck. So go through with it. You're young enough to have it. I'll be right by your doctor. I'll take care of it. So we had a little sister. Her name was Celina. C-E-L-I-N-A. And she was like a little doll, because we were so much older, and we played with her, we catered to her, we took her on a bicycle ride, and we took her in a little wagon, and we took her everywhere, as you know, because she's like a little doll, somebody to play with. It's really sad. To go through, to wipe out such a beautiful family, such warm, affectionate, totally devoted to one another. Sad, very sad.
Tell me a little bit about Lodz at that time. Was it a big city, a little city?
It was a big city. And in the summer, we went right after school for 2 months. We went to the country. Daddy had built a villa where we lived in the summer. And when we moved, we only took our clothing with us and our bedding. The villa was all furnished all year round, and there were some people that lived there. In the back of the villa, you know, it was prepared for somebody to take care of it, you know, all year round. And after we came back from the country, we prepared with clothing and everything else and books and whatnot, back to school, back to work, so to speak. And mother was on her toes getting all four children ready. Big task, I'm sure.
Was your family a religious family?
No, my family were not religious. My father would drive, ride on Shabbat. He was not dressed in the Hasidic clothing ever. And our house was not religious. We didn't have any different dishes for dairy and for meat, but we had several, I remember, several different patterns for different holidays to use, but not, and tradition was kept. Tradition primarily. Friday night was a traditional dinner. Everybody had to be at the table. No one could get up until they'd be excused. No one would ask to be excused until daddy or mother put their fork and knife down. That was a no-no. This was not done. don't ask to be excused until daddy and our and mother are put, have put the fork and knife down on the plate. So we knew that we are kind of at liberty to ask, could we be excused? And that wasn't for long, just for emergency, to the bathroom, and then you had to come back and join them in singing the traditional songs, you know. After dinner, you thank God for the food, and it was, and then after that, I remember we, the whole family after dinner, got dressed beautiful, and we went walking on the avenue. So we would see everybody and say, good Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom, you know. And it, everybody showed off in their best clothing.
What did you like to do when you were a little girl? What was your, what were your favorite things to do?
I was a mischief. I was really a mischief. I liked to climb the trees. I got into a lot of mischief. I went in sometimes to somebody's garden and pulled some flowers that weren't mine. And then somebody called my parents and they told them about it. And I got warned. Then my daddy, may he rest in peace, used to say, well, baby, the bucket is almost full. When the bucket is full, you know what's going to happen. My bell comes off. Now I'm going to use it. So you better watch out. Boy, did we watch it. I had one weapon in my life. And I was, the war broke out, and I was already 16 years old. And it was one time that I had a spanking. I had warnings all through my life, but I didn't think it would happen.
All right, we're going to take a break now to change tapes, and then we're going to start back with the beginning of the... All right, this is the Helen Colin interview, tape number two. Helen, when did things start to change in your city? When did you feel that...
I remember in 1939, there were whispers, you know, my parents wanted to spare us from the news. And as you probably know, we at that time didn't have televisions. We had a little radio that my parents will hide in the back somewhere so we wouldn't hear the news. This is when Hitler came to power in Germany. And there were rumors that he is very ugly to Jews, and that Jews are being thrown out, chased out of their homes, all of their belongings taken away. And my father and mother were whispering to each other, and so did other parents, to spare the children. And I remember my father proceeded to apply for visas for the whole family to go to Palestine at the time. It was not Israel. And it was under the British rule. And they had to secure, like, I don't know, $5,000 a person, $10,000 a person. It was an awful lot of money, because I remember when we gave up everything and were ready to go to Palestine, my parents even sold the silverware, because in Europe you don't have stainless steel. When you get married, you get silver and china and porcelain and crystal and all that. So they sold everything in order to secure by the British government the to guarantee our welfare, our not being not have to be a burden to the government. So everything was done, and we were ready to move get closer to the ship, because at that time we could only go by boat. And my older sister had gotten sick that night before we were supposed to leave, and she had appendicitis attack and wound up in the hospital. And we missed the ship, and the government wouldn't refund our money. And my daddy had a nervous breakdown because we were penniless. And the only thing we had was a summer home, because that daddy insisted to leave to the family, whoever wants to use it, for the summer. And so we had only the summer home to go back to, and no flatware, no dishes, no nothing, because everything was given away or sold to secure the amount of money that they requested. My mother was very adventurous, although she was the youngest in the family and she never worked, but she couldn't see Daddy go down the tube, so to speak. Daddy wouldn't speak to anybody, he didn't want to see anyone. He had a nervous breakdown. At the time I didn't know what a nervous breakdown was, but now I do know. And mother converted that villa to a coffee and cake parlor, an ice cream parlor. And I remember so well the balconies and the verandas in the front and in the back. Mother started making little curtains, you know, and draped them back with big bows, you know, and converted that whole thing for the summer. And slowly, and we all helped, all of us children, because we realized that we have to do something to help the family. And slowly mother would persuade daddy to come out. She put on, you see in Europe in the restaurants you wear white coats, just like the doctors, either jackets or full-length coats. And she put on daddy a white jacket and she says, "Darling, I want you to help me. I really need your help. We are so busy. I just want you to sit by the register. Just watch the register, please." At first he would open the door slightly and look out. He was so embarrassed because we remained penniless. And now all the family helped us put the money together, you know. That was really a very hard time, I would imagine, for anybody. And in retrospect, I read their emotions so clearly. They were very, very heartbroken, both. But mother didn't want to give up. So she converted that villa that we had to an ice cream parlor, and people would come in and they would visit, and it was so beautiful. It was really so nice. And that 3 months, 2 months, whatever it was, gave us enough money to start in the city again, start back. And daddy came back to himself and he started seeing his friends, and it was new life for a short time, unfortunately, because...
Which summer was that? What was the year?
That was in 1939, Hitler came to power, and we worked on it desperately to get out. Our daddy was determined, we're leaving, we're not going to be there. And this is when he secured the money with the help of the family. Everybody pitched in to have us go. At least somebody would leave from the family, and then there may be a chance for the rest of them to get out if it becomes unbearable. If it's true what they read, what they heard on radio and so far, But it wasn't meant, because as I mentioned earlier, you know, my sister got sick and we lost everything, but we, mother and daddy, started getting back on their feet when we started getting people from Germany. They evacuated Jews from Germany and sent them to Poland. And these people didn't have any place to go. They had no relatives, they had no family there, they had no friends because they were in Germany. And many of them didn't even speak Jewish. And I remember that he came in and he says, you know, we're going to have to make room for somebody in the dining room, the living room, I don't care. We have to let somebody in here because they have no place to stay. And mother said, whatever you say, go pick a family, a small family, because we are six in our family and we only have two bedrooms, living room, dining room, and a little bitty kitchen, very small kitchen. And she says, do what you want to. It so happened that the Jewish organization made room for them in different places, and we didn't have anybody move in with us. But shortly afterward, they closed the ghetto. They chased us all out of our homes into a ghetto, a certain part of Lodz, where there was, it was like out of the city limits, you know, and there was hardly in any of the homes running water, no bathrooms. It was in a very, very primitive part of the city. And they announced that we have to, everybody has to leave, those that will not obey will be shot. Well, my daddy knew a lot of people, so he went to that part of the city and he approached one of his friends that he knew before the war. And he says, you know they're gonna assign other people, you know me, you know my family, why don't you let us move in? That family was a man and wife, husband and wife, and a daughter, and a son-in-law, and a child, a newborn baby. They had one bedroom, living room, dining room combination, and again, a tiny little kitchen, almost like a closet. And they said, you're welcome to move in. Please bring your family. So we gathered all of our belongings, minus, of course, furnishings, because we were not allowed to take our furniture with us. We took a backpack and a suitcase, and we walked out of our home that we were raised, born and raised in.
When was that?
That was in 1940.
What time of the year?
September 1940.
Do you remember what you took with you?
My mother packed the bag for me. Only I took with me my... I took the backpack that mother made for me, and I took with me my satchel that I had for school with the school supplies, school work, the books, and whatever I had there with me.
How old were you then?
Pardon me?
How old were you?
I was 16 years old. I was 16 years old. And we came into that place called ghetto. We put our belongings in the corner so we don't disturb the people. And we went about hoping it's going to be a few days, a couple of weeks, it will end. It didn't till 1944. In 1943, we were deported from the ghetto.
Tell me a little bit about life in the ghetto for your family. What was it like there as you spent those years?
Very bad. It was so bad that there were rations announced on the walls, you know, announcements were made on the walls that tomorrow in this and this section they're going to give rations. So my sister and I, or my brother and my sister, or my brother and myself, would go early in the morning, 4 or 5 o'clock, and stay in line in hopes that they'll give us some potatoes or carrots or beets or maybe a slice of bread or something, because it was very bad. And the streets were, I mean, all over the streets and the sidewalks were bodies from starvation. Men, women, and children you could find all over, and we just automatically stepped over and went on to wait in line in hopes to get something to eat for the next day to survive. We had no car, no truck, no transportation at all to even start cleaning the streets from these bodies, because some of them were already rotten from lying around. And I remember the president of the ghetto made an announcement, and he says, you're going to have to do something, all of you together, we're going to have to do something, or we're all going to die from sickness. We have to pick up those bodies. Some ingenious decided to break a door, an inside door, and find a bicycle with two wheels and put that door on top and load bodies on top of that door, you know, and 2-3 people would pull it and another one would push it, or and we would bring it to the cemetery. In the cemetery was no time to bury them, so they put the bodies in before the cemetery. They had built like a barrack, just temporary, to place them, and they put them one on top of the other, you know, heads this way, legs this way, and there were lines. It was only about enough to walk through between the piles of bodies. I would have probably never seen that had I not one day gone to look for my father. My father was 49 years old, and one evening he did not come home. After curfew, they had to come home. There was no way you could be in the street. In the ghetto, we didn't find our father. And early in the morning, my mother was crying. We were crying, where's daddy, where's daddy? And my sister and I went to the morgue where they kept those bodies. And my sister says, I'm going through here and look to see if I can recognize daddy. And I says, and I'm going to go through here. And on the side she was going, were the legs, and my father had one toe on top of the other. And she says, stop, stop, there's daddy here. So we took off some bodies from down were on top of him, and we moved them. And we found daddy with his eyes wide open, his mouth open. He was like packing something to eat so he can still live. We found him there and we took him out from all the other bodies. And my sister says, what are we going to do now? the cemetery was just a few feet away, but there was no shovel, there was no equipment to bury Daddy. So I found and my sister little branches from old trees, and we started digging, you know. And we made a shallow little grave and put Daddy in. And then as we were going home, I says, "Now you're gonna tell Mommy what happened to Daddy." And she says, "No, no, no. Mother loves you more. You're gonna tell Mommy." And I said, "No, you're the oldest. You have to tell Mother." We didn't have to tell Mother. When we came in and we were hysterical. We embraced Mother, embraced each other, you know, my little brother, my little sister. They were crying, they didn't know why. They just knew that Daddy wasn't there. And finally Mother says, "You found Daddy somewhere, yes, did you?" And we both said, "Yes." And we took Mother and my little sister, my little brother, and we went back to show her where we buried Daddy. It was hard, the hardest thing to do. Very, very hard. When your father's 49 years old and we were so young, you know. He was in prime of his life. Very handsome and very, very devoted family man. Why this happened, I still don't know. I ask myself over and over this question. Why? Why? After this, this was like 1944, Daddy passed away in 1943, the early part of 43, in September of 43, we were evacuated from Auschwitz, from the ghetto.
Tell me how they evacuated you.
They made announcements that we have to report to the railroad stations. Those that we catch you in the house will be shot on the spot, and we have to evacuate. I have jumped one episode. May I retract?
Please.
And come back, darling, because I was married during the war, and my sister-in-law's husband was an engineer. And so when they liquidated the ghetto, the Germans said, the doctors, engineers, and those productive and bright minds are welcome to remain. The rest must go. So my sister-in-law suggested that I and my husband would come and stay with them, be safe, so to speak. Unfortunately, they gathered all the intelligent people and they destroyed them in the ghetto.
How?
They guessed the place where they were concentrated. And my sister-in-law had a little boy, 7 years old, such a smart young boy. And my brother-in-law, we found that out later in the year, after the war. Because when my husband came to me and he says, "Do you feel like you want to go with me?" I says, "Honey, this is a war. I love you dearly, but I says, if you want to go with your sister, I understand. I understand you want to be with them, but I have to be with my family. I want to go wherever they are going to take us." So he says, "Then I'm staying with you too." And I was very sick already in the ghetto. I had tuberculosis. I was coughing up blood, and I was a mess before even going into camp. And he would try so hard, my poor late husband, to get us something, to sell something, to make something for somebody to give us anything extra to bring home for me. And his sister says, you know, it's a very contagious disease. You're going to get sick. Don't drink from this glass. Don't eat with the same spoon. He says, whatever happens to Helen could happen to me. I don't care. And he didn't want to go with them. He stayed down with me. And so when they liquidated the ghetto, I went with my family, and we were packed to capacity in railroad, in closed boxed cars, men, women, and children. And I remember my husband got very ill on the train because we were several days and nights on the train. They never let us out for any emergencies. You can imagine what took place, the filth that we lived in. And then he would put his head on my lap. And I remember, like today, he was burning up. He had fever, such a high fever. And my mother was right next to us. And I says, Mommy, they're going to destroy us. This is no way they're going to let us survive. I looked, we found some writings on the walls in the boxcars with lipstick scratched with nails. You're going to die. You're going to death. You're going to death camp. You're not going to survive. And when I said that to my mother says, I would wash your mouth with soap if I had soap. You don't say that. The Germans are very cultural, very fine people. Nobody kills other human beings. She was in denial, complete denial to the very end.
Before we go on, I'd like to go back. Tell me about meeting your husband and about getting married in the ghetto.
I met my husband, he was already about 2 years in the camps. And it was a miracle that the president of the ghetto was a neighbor of theirs before the war. And they sent 50 men from the concentration camp to another camp for destruction, to destroy them, because my husband was like a 60 pounds. He was swollen, he looked awful. And my husband's brother was engaged to my older sister. So when these 50 men were stopped in the ghetto and the president was responsible for them, four German soldiers guided them on that trip to the guest chamber, because in the camps they were in, there was no guest chamber. And they were taking these 50 men were taken to destruction because they couldn't work anymore. They were so ill. So the president, as for curiosity, he stopped in the, so to speak, prison in the ghetto. Because he had to be responsible. He said, if one person is missing, we're going to take 10 and kill them. So tomorrow morning, he says, we want to see Litzmannstadt. They named Lodz, the Germans, Litzmannstadt. And those four German soldiers, the Gestapo, said to the president, we leave these 50 men in under your protection. If one is missing in the morning, 10 are going off the street, and including you. So he went to see who these people are. And my husband recognized it. And he says, aren't you Mr. Gertler? He says, yes, how do you know me? Because he looked awful. And he says, you are my father's friend before the war. I'm Colin, he says. I'm the younger one. David is my brother.
if he is alive, and I'm the younger one, Coppell. And he says, oh, and he couldn't make a big to-do because the others will know this. And he says, okay. He didn't know whether it was him, so he went to the oldest sister of my husband. She, before the war, won Miss Poland. She was so beautiful. She was the one that was married to this engineer and had a little boy that remained in the ghetto and was destroyed. And he went there and he says, I want you to come with me and see if this is really your brother. But I can't let you see his face. I mean, I can't let him see your face. You're going to look through a peephole because of the others. And she went and she was hysterical. She came by and told us that he's going to try and save him, take him out of that group, because we knew that they were going to destruction. They couldn't stand on their feet. They were so weak. And horrible, emaciated and sick. The next day he got him out and he put another man. And my husband did it till he died. He couldn't forget. He had to have those 50 men in the morning when these four SS men came to pick him up, the Gestapo men. And he took a young boy that stole maybe a few potatoes or a few carrots, you know. And he placed him in my husband's place. And the boy was screaming, why do you put me together with these, we used to call them Musulmen. Those bad people. And he says, I didn't do anything. I just stole a few potatoes to bring it home to my mom. Why do you do that? I don't want to be with them. And within no time, you know, my husband heard that. And until he died, he said, my conscience bothers me. Because someone else took my place and I'm alive.
We're going to pause right here and we're going to change the tapes. Helen Colin interview, tape number 3. Helen, what year was that?
That was in 1943. In 1943 we had...
What time of the year?
It was in the fall. It was cold. It was snow when we were deported.
No, when you met your husband, when your husband came to
the ghetto. Oh, my husband came, it was in the spring. And the president saved him.
The spring of 1943?
1943.
After your father had died?
After my father had died. He came and we went to see him, and then the ghetto had a hotel with food and everything to reward the workers that are good workers, you know. And so he put him into that hotel to revitalize him, to put him on his feet. And I remember I went to see him several times with my sister and my mother. And I went to see him to his sister's house. And he was so scared. He was so, his sister, whatever little we had, you know, she prepared a little, because it was customary for anybody that walks in a European home, you're served, being fruit or sweets or whatever, you know, or just tea and a cookie. And I don't know what she served, but he was so afraid, and he didn't know already. He was 3 years in the camps, and he didn't know, he didn't see a fork, a knife, or anything, a plate, you know. So he was like a wild person, you know. And then after he was assigned for a couple of weeks to this hotel, I went to see him, and the grounds were very pretty, you know. And I And we walked around and we talked and we sat on a bench, and he says, you know, I one word came to another, and we decided we really cared for each other. And he jokingly says, you know, if we would get married in the ghetto, we would get a special ration of food. The ration may sometimes consist of a few spoons of coffee, a little, some vegetables, maybe a little flour to bake something. No eggs. I haven't seen in 5 years an egg. And he says, why don't we get married? And I said, you know, and we were probably, I don't know, there was some fictitiously getting married in order to get a ration. And the marriage was performed by the president of the ghetto. And it was 100 or maybe more couples, you know. And I remember when we got married, my mother made a reception and for his family and my family, and the reception consisted of coffee grinds. She made little patties like cookies and covered it with something, you know, I don't know, some white seeds that looked like sugar. And this was the reception. And my sister, till today, when we talk about it, she says, you had some reception. Would they ever believe what a reception you had after the wedding? I said, nobody would believe, but I still remember the table. Mother had a knack of doing things that was so elegant. It was with nothing, with really nothing, she had prepared that reception.
How long was it from the time he came into the ghetto until you married? When did you get married?
I got married in 1943, and I wasn't married 1 year when they separated us.
What month were you married?
In the fall. I got married in the spring, and September, I think it was sometime September that we got evacuated from the ghetto.
Before we go there, you said that your sister was engaged to his brother. Did they also marry in the ghetto?
No. My sister never knew till the end of the war that her fiancé is alive, that my brother-in-law is alive.
So he was not in the ghetto with
you? He was not in the ghetto. He was cut in the beginning of the ghetto with his brother at separate different times, different days, and sent away to work, to build camps. You know, the very beginning, in 1940, when they first invaded the Poland lodge and the ghetto, the Germans came every day, sometimes twice a day, on trucks and grabbed anybody off the street, literally. Anybody off the street. I remember that one time I wanted to go and visit my aunt, and a raid came. We called it a raid, because that was a raid. They came and raided the city and grabbed anybody. And I was caught in the raid, and I didn't want to be sent away. I didn't want to be separated from my family. The bond was so strong to be together no matter what, even to destruction, but be together. And I remember that I ran up a house that was partially already vacant, and I went all the way up to the attic. And the attic, they primarily used the attic for hanging clothes to dry. And I remember, there were some old straw mattresses, because we didn't have at that time in the ghetto, you know, regular mattresses. We had straw mattresses, but people didn't want to throw them away, so they put them up on the attic. And I dug myself like a mouse under that mattress, and I felt like I'm going to choke. So I gradually came to an opening where they had little archways on the attic so the clothes will dry easier. And I stuck my nose out to breathe, you know, to breathe a little bit. I couldn't breathe. And at that moment, I saw a lot of trucks down below. And I said, oh my God, if they're going to see my nose, they're going to come up and they'll kill me here, mother, now they'll find me, you know. So I dug under the mattress more and barely breathed through, nearly through the mattress. But when I heard people crying, I stuck my nose out and I looked out there, and there was across the street from that vacant house was a hospital. And in the hospital they had some sick people and some mothers that just delivered the baby. And these SS men went up floor to floor and opened the window and threw down those snowboards on the bed of a truck, on a flat bed. And one of the mothers were crying. They were trying to reach the newborn baby. And he pushed her out the window. And I, to tell you how much in denial my mother was, I came home after the raid, after it got quiet and all. And my heart was jumping out of my mouth. I was so scared. I was so afraid. I've never seen an infant thrown from a third-story floor. And the mother pushed with it. I went home and I told my mother. And my mother took me, I remember like today, by the shoulders. And she says, stop that. You had a horrible dream. That doesn't happen. People don't do that to other people. And I said, Mommy, you always believed me. I won't lie to you. Till this day, it hurt me that she didn't believe me. She couldn't comprehend that. I think she couldn't take it. She denied it. And didn't know how. It hurt me so much. It hurt me because I never lied to my mother. Unless I wanted to get away without getting punished, you know.
Do you remember when that was that you saw them throw the babies from the hospital?
That was shortly before they evacuated us. It must have been in 1944. And sometimes June, July. Because later on, you know, shortly after that, we were evacuated completely out of the ghetto, you know. And that is when my sister-in-law and her husband and the child remained, because they were intelligent and professional people.
I'm going to go back to the spring of 1943 for a moment. You've just married. Did your husband get stronger? Did he get well again? You said he only weighed 60 pounds when he came.
He got stronger after he got a job working for the one factory, and I worked for another factory, because we all had to work. And I remember I was assigned to, we were doing uniforms for the German army. And the fabric is so hard, and I never till this day learned how to really use a thimble. And tips of my fingers were always bleeding. And one of the supervisors there came to me. We knew my family very well. And he says, you are a tough cookie to break. I said, they're gonna think that we sabotage this, they're going to find blood on the uniforms, and they're going to come and kill us all. He says, why aren't you learning to use this? You won't bleed, you won't hurt your fingers. I wore it here and I pushed it with these fingers, you know. I just couldn't get the hang of it. But we manufactured those uniforms and they were pressed by others. It was like a production factory, you know. We had to produce an X amount, otherwise they are not going to deliver the next day's ration, and the ration was not enough to live and too much to immediately die, because many of us would have preferred to die. I mean, this was no life. And filth for 4 years, not to have a piece of bar of soap. It was awful. And then what? One time we were, after I was married, I was, we had our own little apartment. One room was issued to us from another family, but had a separate entrance, and that room was made into, I remember we didn't have a bed, but we had a couch that opened to a bed. So after we got up, it was so nice, it was a living room, and Mother gave us a little oriental carpet to put in the middle of the floor, and a little bridge table and two chairs. And the kitchen was, one of my boyfriends was an electrical engineer, so he connected electric burner that would not show that we use electricity. Because we weren't allowed to use electricity, otherwise you would, you know. So he did something, you know, and the little kitchen had a little, mother had an old oriental silk screen, and she gave it to me, so we covered that little kitchenette with that silk screen. And the table, underneath the table was a cellar. So my husband was very ingenious, and he says, you know what, if they raid this house, what are we going to do? And I says, well, I guess we're going to have to go like everybody else. He says, oh no, I'm not going. So he went to the cellar and he concocted a hole in the door, in the floor, and attached a piece of string. So when we pushed the carpet back, we jumped into the cellar when we heard the raid, the trucks and all of that. And after we got in, he pulled that string and straightened out the carpet. And we hid there every time there was a raid. One time his older sister, the one that was remained in ghetto, was married. This is his first married sister. And she was caught in the raid. And they were holding her before the send them to the railroad tracks. So they were just like a holding camp, you know. And I remember my husband says, I can't let them take her away. I can't let them take her. I said, well, you're going to go and they're going to take you too. So what is there to do? He says, I'll find a way. I'll find a way to get her out of there. I want to get her out of there. Whatever happens later, we'll worry about it. And I said, but you're not going by yourself. I'm going with you. So I went with him. And I remained across from that camp in a little hut, like a little outhouse. And through the cracks, I looked, and I says, how are you going to get in? You see, it's a gate. They don't let anybody in or out. I says, what are you going to do? What is you? Tell me. He says, I don't know what I'm going to do. I can't let her go. And he ran out before I had a chance. And I says, well, if I run with him, they'll take me too. So I remained in that little hut. And he got up to the gates of this prison, this holding block. And there was on a wagon, bakers came to deliver bread to the prisoners, but they had to report in the office. So they left that wagon unattended for a minute, and he got himself all white with that flour and everything, and he took that wagon and ran in to the camp, screaming to the top of his lungs, calling his sister. His sister looks out from the second story window, and he says, come on, come on. Meanwhile, the two guys came out, the bread is gone, the wagon is gone. And he is still looking for his sister, so he got his sister, put her on the bread, covered her with that mess of rag that the bread was covered, and took her out of there. He left the wagon in maybe 10 feet before he came to that shack, and we stayed there, he, his sister, and myself. We stayed there probably for the day until it got dark that we could get home. Because in the daytime, there was no way that we could have gotten home undetected. He saved his sister. And one time his sister was in my house, and we hid in the cellar, and she got saved there too for the day. Who knew what's going to happen the next day? We didn't know.
So then there came the announcement the ghetto was going to be liquidated. And you went with your family. Did your husband go with you in the car?
My husband went with me.
The whole family was together.
The whole family was in the box cars.
Tell me.
All together.
Tell me what happened now. This was in 1944?
44.
What month?
September, I think. October. Cold. It was so cold. And we were brought to this, packed in the wagon where we couldn't hardly sit, let alone stretch out. And those were lucky that were against the wall because the icicles sipped through the cracks and we were able to wet our lips at least, you know. And my husband was lying on my lap. His head was lying on my lap. He was burning with fever. And I kept telling him, you'll be all right, you'll be all right. Please take care of my little brother. Be together. Don't be separated. Be together. I said, kind of like subconsciously you would think that the men are going to be separated from the women. And I said, don't ever leave each other. Be together. And they were together. And left.
What happened when you arrived? Where did you go on that train?
It was such a crazy place with inmates playing symphony on one side, huge German shepherds barking with the SS people with guns drawn, telling us, get out, you dirty Jew, get out, you dirty dog, and all kinds of names. You in cussing, you verfluchte Jude, and incredible. It was like a madhouse. And people behind bars, behind the screaming and yelling, throw us something, whatever you have to eat, because they take it away from you. Please throw us something. And they were like double barbed wires, not bars, wires. And when we tried to throw something, and if it fell between the wires, you know, the barbed wires, we noticed that some of the people got stuck there and they couldn't get off the wires. And I couldn't put two and two together until finally somebody told us that they were electrocuted on those wires because they were trying to get something from whatever we have left. And we wanted to give it to them. But on one side, we didn't believe them. And then this is music playing, a beautiful symphony. The dogs are barking and the men are screaming at us. It was a total chaos. It was a crazy house. And before I had a chance to say anything, men separate, women separate. And that's when they separated me from my mother, from my little sister. And then my little sister turned around and she said, "Mommy, Mommy, come with me." And mother turned around and the German, I took off my engagement ring and I gave it to him and I said, "Please," I spoke German, so I begged him. I said, "Tell me where is my mother going and my little sister." And he very politely said, "They're going to do much lighter work, but you're going to, this is war, and you're going to do harder work. You're a young person." I was already 19 years old, and my sister was 22, you know. So we turned around, and the mother says, "Take care of yourself, both of you girls, be good, and we'll see you." I never saw them again. Was the last time I saw her and my little sister. And I still believed, I believed that they are going to be safe, because mother says no such thing. Another human being can't do harm to, one human being can't do harm to another. And I believed it. I strongly believe, I wanted to believe it. I guess I do want it. I did want to believe it. And then when they took my mother away, and they ushered us, young women, some of them from the same school, from the same neighborhood, we grew up together, and they ushered us away and to a barrack, you know. Before that, we spent the night, all night, outdoor, and we were cuddling to each other because I remember it was so cold. It was bitterly cold, snow on the ground, you know. They didn't have time to process us. You see, I don't have a number. I only had a dog tag, and my sister too. They didn't have time to, they needed people to work, you know. So I remember they took we spent the night in the outdoors, and a young girl came over, and we recognized her. She was a neighbor's daughter, and a girl our age. And I asked her by the name. I said, "What are you doing here? You dressed, you see? They took everything away from you." And the first word she says, "Where is your beautiful mother?" And I told her very politely, she went with my little sister because we're going to go to do hard work. She says, "Maloney," she went where my mother went, and my family. There you see the guest chamber. You see the chimney. That's where they went. That's when I found out that right there.
Let's continue. He's going to take care of them. When did you find out what camp you were in, where you were?
That night, that this young girl, that neighbor's daughter, told us that we are in Auschwitz. And she says, "And you're lucky, you are going to be taken out of here within hours to work. You are safe." you are safe. And I realized that I'll never see my mother or my sister again. Because she told us. She told us the truth.
What was that like for you?
It was very hard. It was so hard on us that my sister got like somebody hit her over the head. And she was like a zombie, you know. I pushed her, she went, and when they called her, she went. When she sat down, she was sitting, and she was completely disoriented, the one that I depended so much on. And then slowly, you know, she came to herself, and I never told her because I don't think she heard a word that our friend said about my mother, so I never told her about it. It was a very rough, unexpected time that we couldn't, under any circumstances, comprehend that anything so uncivilized, inhumane could happen. This is 50 years after my liberation. I still can't accept it. I have nightmares and I'm running and trying to catch my mother. She's not there. It's very difficult to. Under normal circumstances, we all know that we're just passing through here. I know that, God willing, you know, I will die a normal, of old age, you know. But I wouldn't be destroyed at the age of 44. I had a beautiful life. 44 years old, none of us except me was married. That's when mother insisted I should see one child married. Please get married. And I did. And it was for her that I did it. And I'm very glad I did it because she enjoyed a little pride, a little something, you know.
We're going to take another break to change tapes. Tape number 4 of Helen Collins' interview. Helen, you and your sister have just spent your first night in Auschwitz. Can you pick it up from there and tell us what happened next?
We spent the night in Auschwitz, and that first night we unfortunately found out that we will never see our mother and our little sister. It came through a neighbor of ours that was already there a few years. She helped build the camp, and she said to us, I envy you because you are going to be out of here within hours. You're going to work. I can't get out of here. I'll probably wind up with your mother and your sister, and I know it. And I'll change places with you anytime. And I couldn't at that time comprehend the what she said, because she was dressed nice. She was one of the leaders in the camp, like a, as they say in Jewish, a big macher, you know. And I couldn't put two and two together. I guess I was too disturbed by the fact that she gave me such a horrible news about my mother and my little sister, and nothing registered, nothing. And it didn't, within a few hours, they took us to a barrack, opened doors, and announced that we should get disrobed completely, leave everything,
Do not take anything with you. Leave it on a little pile right in front of the door. And when you come out, you'll have it. And it was that was our original clothing that we traveled in. And we did. We, one by one, got undressed and walked in. We were already all women. The men were already away from us. And we got into this barrack. It was a huge barrack with a few little showers hanging off the ceiling, and could have just as well been a guest chamber, but fortunately they needed, fortunately for me and the rest of us, they needed 800 women to work. And I was one, and my elder sister of the 800 that we were sent out the next morning. We got into the shower and never came back that same door. We would let out another door, and there men were standing laughing at us because we were completely nude, wet, and they were making fun of us. And we couldn't figure out what's next. And they called us to come forward. And when we came forward, they were there with a shaver, a hand shaver, and they shaved our hair. And then we had to stand with the hands up, legs stretched, to examine if we didn't hide anything. I hid my parents' picture in my mouth, just the heads. And they made me open my mouth because there were some that had gold crowns at which point they would pull them and throw them in a box. The box was bigger than me, full of crowns, you know, gold teeth and crowns. They didn't care whether the crown came out with the tooth, without any anesthetics, without anything. They just pulled it with a plier. And I didn't know that they were going to look in my mouth. I got the beating of my life because I had these pictures hidden of my parents. I wanted to have something. Unfortunately, I couldn't save them. And then they pushed me further. And there was another woman there with a brush that she dipped in a bucket with kind of chlorine. And she rubbed it on my face, on my head, and it dripped all over my eyes. For hours, my eyes were burning. And she put it under my arms, between my legs. It burned the devil out of us. We were crying, all of us, from that. And then we had to go further away, where they assigned us clothing. We never did see our clothes anymore. And when they assigned us the clothing, I was a size 4, maybe. And they gave me a woman's size, maybe 14, 18 dress, a dress that was to my ankles, and it was so huge. And I really, no underwear, no shoes, nothing. That dress, and it was so bitterly cold, so I tried to hold that dress, really hold it so it wouldn't blow the cold air so much. And we came a little further back, and they gave us wooden clogs. I couldn't walk in those wooden clogs because the snow stuck to it and created like a ball, and you couldn't walk on it. So we walked barefoot and held the wooden clogs because if they asked you where you have them, what'd you do with them? You know, So we had to have them. And we were assigned to, we were in line, about 800 women, I remember, a lot of young women. And from Auschwitz, we went to a camp to Bremen. And in Bremen, we were assigned to work with German bricklayers and cement workers, and we were the ones that carried the water. There was no water nearby, so we walked. 50 women were assigned to each project every day, every morning, and they gave us those holders, you know, wooden holders to carry the buckets of water to the bricklayer. And the bricklayer would mix it with cement, and then we'd carry the bricks to him, you know. It was all in line, like assigned like a factory. And that was every day. Every day, they woke us up in the morning with a whistles, and you dirty dogs, you get up. You get up, you dirty dogs. And the next day we didn't know where we're gonna be. We were never assigned to the same project every day. It was another 50 women that went to that project. I was the next day assigned to, or 2 days later, to clean up there were a lot of homes that were destroyed by the British and the Americans, and they wanted to reuse the bricks. So we were assigned 50 women to, with little tools, to scrape off the concrete from the bricks and set the bricks up to be reused. We were in a home where it was partially destroyed, but as hungry as we were, something told us that in the basement may be something there. And we found jars, some of them broken, and who cared, you know, a piece of glass, it didn't matter. Jars of pickled beans, preserves, preserved cherries and pears. And I remember so vividly, like today, we were like children in a candy store. We didn't know what to do. And one found out from the other, before you knew it, all 50 of us were in the cellar. And the two men and two women that were watching us in uniform, couldn't figure out why we are not at work cleaning those bricks. So they came to the cellar and they says, they started yelling at us, and you come out, you dirty dogs, you come out, you pigs, and all kinds of language. And so my sister, being that she was the older, she told them, she says, you get out, all of you, get out. I'll try to save some. I put it in my pocket. I put it in anywhere as I can. I'll take it with me. Because we knew we're not going to probably be assigned the next day. And some of the other group would have it. So, you know, survival is the strongest thing. So we try to eat as much as we could. And my sister remained there, you know, they couldn't figure all 50. So three were over here, five were over here, a few were in the other corner. They couldn't figure out that she was missing. And she was loaded. Poor thing was so full of stuff trying to take with her to the camp to divide it in our barrack, you know. Among the closest, maybe not all of them, but the closest that we were, kind of a group holding on to each other. And finally, you know, she came out because it was close to leaving. It was almost dark, and they loaded us on a truck, on a
There was one truck man, a driver, that was so immersively ugly, so inhumane. His truck had a little board around the platform, one board. And so when he loaded us on the truck, unless you stood right by the where he drives, what do you call that? The cab of it. He would make a turn at 50 miles an hour, where one would pull the other trying to hold on, and consequently will fall off. At which point he got hysterical and backed up, and we inevitably took with us always one or two bodies to the camp, because we had to bring the 50 people, regardless were dead or alive. He was so ugly that whenever we were assigned to his truck, we knew somebody is going to die. One time we were assigned to him, and as we boarded the truck, I talked to him because he was a man maybe in his 40s. He was not old, he could have been my father. And I talked to him in German, and I said to him, I hope your child is not mistreated. Well, he told the guard, and the two men didn't want to punish me, they didn't want to whip me, but the two women in those boots, and there must have been women that were very primitive country women that had no education, no feeling, no compassion. And she says, you dirty dog, you talk to one of our men? You're not supposed to talk, you know that. And I got a whipping, I was like a ball between the two of them. That's how they whipped me, because I asked them a simple question. I says, would you want to treat your child like this? I said, please have mercy on us. We do the job the best we can. Have a little mercy. And I didn't think they heard me, because they were in other parts trying to get all of us on the truck. But he told them. So that was one very bad experience. Next time we were assigned to lay railroad tracks, and lying them down and bolt them down is not so hard, but when you've never seen a welding iron, and you give in a welding iron, I've never seen one. And he says, you weld these two rails together and make sure that there wouldn't be an accident in here, or your head is. And so I started doing it, and all these sparks flew all over me, and I was really burned. And I knew I'm not doing the job right. I knew I wasn't doing it right. So I turned around and I asked the same guy, not that driver, but one of the supervisors that wanted us to do this. And I said, if you be so kind to show me how to do it, I'll do it right. You have to only show me once. I want to do it right. I think it was a very reasonable request. I didn't want to sabotage the train, and I wanted to do it right. And he turned around the rifle, and he hit me in the mouth. I was bleeding profusely, like an animal. And I had nothing, no tissue, no... I could only grab part of my dress and hold up. I didn't know whether I was bleeding. He knocked out four of my teeth. And I didn't know whether I was bleeding from my teeth or from the nose or what happened, the lips. I was a mess, a total mess. And all this time, my sister couldn't come to my rescue because she shouldn't, she mustn't identify herself that she is related to me, because the object of breaking our hearts was to separate us. So she didn't say anything, and she turned around and she cried to her friends, and she says, go and see if you can do something for her. So whenever one came to me, he says, you want to get it too? And he pulled the rifle, turned the rifle around with the butt of the rifle, you know, and he says, you want to get it too? So it was impossible to be human and act human and not being able to express yourself, to say something, to ask, to talk like a human being. We were addressed as, and I was 1919, my sisters was 1920. We were addressed, they look at the tag on a piece of rope, and they says, 1919, you come over here, 1920, you go there. That was the life. It's incredible to looking back to all of this. I often wonder, what so little Kinderstube means home, upbringing, because I was so young when everything was destroyed. I often wonder how I can be civilized and fit in this environment with true civilization. I don't know. I often wonder how. I think it was my parents' prayers. And she always said, as I was growing up, she says, you should only have, how did she put it I could say it in Polish, you should have, you should only look beautiful and smart by strangers. And I think they prayed for it, because I have no strangers. Everybody I touch is always, remains always a friend of mine, because I love humanity. I still love human beings. To me, you cannot buy a human being. You cannot replace a human being. Everything, any possession, can be replaced, but no human being. And all this, more so than ever before, after the war, I learned how important a human being is, how serious, how cherished. We should cherish every moment with every human being. I have no animosity to anybody. It was a time, a wrong time to be born in, a wrong time to be raised. But I do hope for my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren that life will be for them a little bit more humane. And people will be a little bit more cordial to each other, more acceptable to each other's, for each other's feelings and each other's beliefs and nationality and race. We must respect one another. There is no other way the world will survive.
Let's go back to the camp. How long were you there?
How long was I in?
How long were you in the camp?
I was in the camp since September of 93 till September or October, I don't know exactly, darling, forgive me. And I was liberated on April 15, 1945.
So you went to the camp in 19... I thought you... So you went to the camp in 1943?
43. They liquidated the ghetto.
In 1943.
And I went to the camp in 43 and was liberated on my birthday, April 15th, on my birthday. The night before my birthday, it's a very interesting, in Bergen-Belsen, the Germans had given the barrack, they distributed extra rations of bread. And they stopped by my barrack. The barrack before me had received the bread. And I told my sister, I says, isn't that terrible? My birthday is tomorrow. I could have gotten extra ration of bread. I wished I did. She says, well, it got late and they didn't have time to distribute it. Tomorrow they're gonna start by us and they're gonna continue with the other barracks. I says, yeah, I don't know, they may have run out of bread. The next morning we didn't hear whistles, we didn't hear dog barking, we didn't hear people yelling at us, you dirty dogs, you dirty pigs, you get out, you know, and at sometimes 4-5 o'clock in the morning. And we were so scared, like we were always being told when to do what to do. So here we are, it's already daybreak, nobody calls us, nobody wakes us up, nobody tells us to get out. What is going on? They're like abandoned little orphans. And finally it got noisy outside. And not the noise that we used to hear, the dogs barking and them screaming at us, you know, getting up and get ready to go to work. And I remember, and I don't know whether it was my sister or somebody else, they opened the door from the barracks and they looked out, and the first thing they saw was a British Red Cross tank. And they turned around, and I get goose pimples. And they yelled so loud, we're free, we're free, we are free. And we were like little orphans. We were afraid to move, you know, we were lying on these, you know, these bunk beds, and we're afraid to get up and get out. And finally, I remember one of the chaplains came to the door and he opened it wide. And he says, I'm a British chaplain. Who are you? And I spoke a little bit English, not enough to converse, but enough to tell who we were. And he says, you are free, come out, you are free. Some were dancing, some were crying, some were on their knees, you know. And the expressions that each and every one of us had, individual feelings of being free, was something indescribable. It was, that was my birthday. And the British gave us a ration of potatoes, and we didn't have an oven, we didn't have a stove, we didn't have anywhere to cook it. So my sister and her friends put two little bricks together and made a fire from straw and little branches and threw the potatoes in. And then she gave me a potato, and we didn't have a mirror, so they were hysterical because I was so overwhelmed with that baked potato with the ashes and everything. My whole face was all black, the nose, my chin, my cheeks, everything. And they didn't want to tell me, they just started laughing, hysterically. I said, what are you laughing? It's my birthday, I can eat what I want. I have enough potatoes here to celebrate. And they said, if I only had a mirror to show you what you look like. See?
Which birthday was that for you? How old were you?
The 21st birthday. 1944. Excuse me, darling. 22nd birthday. I was born 21st birthday. 21st birthday. And this was the first time that I had seen a civilized person talk to me in a civilized manner.
I'm going to take another break. I'm just going to change tapes one more time. All right, this is tape number 5, Helen Colin interview. Helen, what happened after your liberation?
When I was liberated with my sister, there were rumors that there were some other people liberated, and they processed lists of survivors and exchanged them between camps. And my husband, being in Munich, and I, that's about 1,500 miles away, and I being in Bergen-Belsen, I never expected to see my husband alive again, because when I left him, he had such high fever, and I really didn't. But he read on a list of survivors that his brother is alive, and his brother is in Bergen-Belsen. Well, his brother, we found before we found my husband. His brother found us. So my sister and my brother-in-law were the first or the second couple married after the war in Bergen-Belsen by this chaplain that liberated us. And my brother-in-law had a very close friend, and he kept telling me, he says, Helen, you're so young, and he's so in love with you, he can't tell you, but he really is in love with you, and you know, I would love more than anything to see my brother, but how long are you going to wait? We won't find him. He is not with us by now. We won't find him.
How long had you waited by that time?
This was a few months. And the lists were coming from everywhere, and I have not heard anything from my husband. And I lived, my sister being that she was married, she was assigned a separate little, like a little apartment, you know, for a married couple. And I lived with 4 other girls, a house away from them. It was all in Bergen-Belsen. This was the military housing before the war for the Germans. And they assigned us, after we were liberated, out of the barracks into these houses, which was already more civilized. And I remember that finally, after a long conversation, my brother-in-law says, believe me, if he's alive, he would be here, your husband. He probably is not alive. Go out with him. He wrote already to his family in America that he found the most wonderful girl he wants to bring with him to America. And he is in love with her so much. And she's the sister-in-law. He described everything. He says, go out. So I says, well, time has come. I have to go out with him. So he prepared a picnic basket and 2 bicycles he rented somewhere, God knows where. And I was at my sister's house waiting for him to come pick me up. suddenly from the house I was living in came the elder woman that was like our mother, and she came crying, sobbing, "Helen, your husband is alive, your husband." The girls came running first, but I didn't believe it. I said, "Oh, they're jealous because I'm going out on a date. Ah, that can't be possible." And I was on the second floor with my sister and my brother-in-law waiting for his friend to come pick me up. And then when that elder woman came running, I knew it's true. So my husband walked in there. He had gotten our list of names. He walks in there and he's put down his little satchel, and he was going from Munich on open trains and closed trains, and they gave him a little ration from the hospital, and he finally came, and he walks into the house and looks around. He says, "Again, I didn't find anybody," talking to himself. And she says, "Who are you, and who are you looking for?" And he told her who it is. When he told her, he dropped that little wooden case that he had with him, and he nearly, I mean literally, fell on the floor. And she says, "I'll bring them to you. Your brother is here too, and your sister-in-law, and your wife." And she came running. And me, as I was going down to meet him, I slipped and fell down the hall, slipped down on my back the whole flight. I could barely get up then. But I ran to the next building, and when I saw him, I didn't recognize him. He was still so swollen, you know. Because he was in the hospital by the Americans, kept him in the hospital. He was very sick. And he didn't wait to be released. He just checked himself out. He ran away from the hospital in the hospital uniform, mind you, with a coat over. And he hitchhiked because he had no money. Nobody would give him any money. And he came finally, and that's how we found each other. And of course, the friend of mine, brother-in-law, disappeared. I haven't seen him since.
So what were the names of your husband and his brother? I don't think we've covered that yet.
His brother was 3 years older, and he was married to my sister. His brother-in-law's name was David, and my husband's name was Coppel, K-O-P-E-L.
And was it originally?
Originally,
Colin?
Yes.
Was
that was
Colin?
His name. And the last name was spelled in Europe, K-O-L-I-N. But we have found family in America. When we first came, a cousin of my husband's, he was a professor at New York University, and they have changed their name to C-O-L-I-N, and they were very persistent, they really wanted us to change it to C-O-L-I-N, and this is how we became C-O-L-I-N instead of K-O-L-I-N.
And how long did you wait to come to America?
I was very fortunate because I moved out of Bergen-Belsen to a place called Bremen. In Bremen, we had an American consulate. And in Bremen, I persuaded a lot of people, unbeknownst to me, that we had family that could have sponsored us easy. But the Hebrew Immigration Society sponsored myself and my husband to come to this country. I was every day there. I was really a pest because I found out that I was pregnant. And I said, under no circumstances will I have a child in Germany. I says, there is no way I'm going to commit suicide. I threatened everything. And finally, you know, they could see that I was a very determined person, and they scheduled me on a ship to come to America. I was 3 months pregnant when I came to America, and my beautiful daughter, first one, was born here, and I had already a little family with me because it was my husband's cousins and his wife, and their family that really embraced us.
So when was your daughter born?
My daughter was born 1946, February 24th, 1946.
Where was she born?
In Brooklyn, New York.
And what's her name?
The New York Infirmary.
Now what is your daughter's name?
Muriel, M-U-R-I-E-L. She's named after my mother. My mother's name was Miriam. And I wanted to name her Miriam, and then my cousin said that this is more biblical name. Let's name her Muriel, which is a very American way. And I says, let's go with it.
Did your sister and your brother-in-law stay in Europe longer?
No, they came shortly afterwards. And they stayed with us for a short while because we were very fortunate right after the war to get a little railroad four-room apartment. Our cousins were very nice about that. They found us an apartment, and my husband found a job. And I cried every day because I thought I was so rich and I can't share this with my family. I have everything. Look at this four-room railroad apartment and furniture. Every weekend we went shopping for antique furniture because we wanted to bring back the old home. And that's where my daughter was born. And
how did you come to Texas?
Good question. You know, my sister and my brother-in-law, when they came to America, they had very close friends that came to Texas after the war. Their uncle sponsored them, and he kept writing to them to please come. There is such a, it's much nicer than New York. It's quieter, it's cleaner, it's, and my uncle will give you a job and all that good stuff. And so they said, well, maybe we should go and see, explore this Texas, and perhaps you like it too, and then you come to meet with us. And that's how it started. And we like Texas because it is clean, quiet, nice, and we have been here since 1950.
And did you have other children?
Yes, I have another daughter, also born in New York before I came here, and she is 3 years older than her, 3 years younger than her sister. That's my little one. Her name is Jeannie, J-A-N-I-E, and
when was she born?
She was born 1946.
No, the second, the younger daughter was born
1949. She's 3 years old. January 24th, 1949.
So the four of you came to Texas?
We came to Texas, and we liked Texas, and we stayed on, other than traveling through different parts of the world.
And you and your husband made a life in Houston. What business did you go into?
My husband was in, we were in the jewelry business, and he continued with his business, and he was in the business until 5 years prior to his death. And he passed away in 1991.
There's only one person that we haven't heard of. You said that your little brother went with your husband after you got off the train. Did you find out what happened?
Unfortunately, I did. After the war, I wrote to every conceivable organization, including Sweden and Switzerland, because we found that there are some orphans over there. And unfortunately, it was no one by that name that they could recognize that I finally, you know, I was in this country maybe a couple of years, that my husband broke down, and he says, stop writing, you will not find him. I couldn't tell you before, but when we were separated and you went with the women and you urged me to stay with your little brother, I stayed with him as long as I could. I didn't know where they were going to take me, but I always told him to stay right behind me or next to me. He was very short, and one of the men that selected them chased him out. So next moment my husband told him to take a rock and go behind him and stand on the rock so he'll be taller. The German SS men recognized him, and he was very angry, and he hit him with the rifle. Did not shoot him, but he hit him with the rifle, and my brother's head split open, and they were marched away, and my husband never saw him again. So he says, I tried, believe me, I tried. But that's how I lost my little brother. He got killed in Auschwitz at the selection. They did not think he was able to work. He didn't look mature enough, and he was short. And that was the end. I stopped looking for my brother. Never found him. But at least I knew that my husband was with him to the last moment.
I'm going to come back to the current day. You have grandchildren now. Can you tell us the names of your grandchildren?
I have my oldest one is Michelle, M-I-C-H-E-L-E. And she's the daughter of my oldest daughter. And I also have a grandson by the same daughter and son-in-law. And his name is Philip. And their last name is Michaela, M-E-I-C-L-E-R. And my son-in-law has his own story to tell. He was born in Belgium and was raised in an orphanage. Never knew till the liberation that he was Jewish. His mother and father left him there. His father was killed in Auschwitz, and his mother survived, and she is here with us, and she is rejoicing the two grandchildren as well.
And then you have a third?
And I have a third granddaughter. Her name is Emily. Emily is the daughter of Jeannie, J-E-A-N-I-E. That's my younger daughter, and she is the lady of the family. I'm very, very proud of her because she's a very polite young lady, which is very rare today. That child would never sit down at the table and lift a glass of water without asking anybody at the table if they want something. And that shows me that she's really a jewel. Those are the three, and this is my life, and that's what I live for, and rejoice with them every opportunity, every moment that I have.
Do you have any message for the people that will see this from what you've learned from your life?
I beg everybody that listens to this message to please be polite, be gracious to another human being, regardless of color, race. Because we're all born to live and enjoy life, and we're all entitled to the freedom of life. And unless and until we're going to respect one another, that's the greatest love you can give. Respect. That's all I can say.
Thank you so much. We're going to pause for a moment and round up your family members to come on with you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. This is my husband and me,
the first, probably the first picture taken after the war in Bremen, just before we left Germany to immigrate to America. This is me and my husband, very happy leaving the American consulate with good news that we will get our passports to leave. And that's why we're so happy.
When was this?
Shortly before we left Bremen to America. That was in 1945.
Thank you.
This is me with my first passport, giving me permission to leave Germany to come to the Golden Land of America.
I'm going to read the statement in English right below the German statement on the front of the passport. Says, the bearer of this certificate has been imprisoned by the National Socialism. She is registered at the Office for Dismissed KL Inmates as former prisoner for race. We beg you to give favored attendance to the above person of authorities, official agencies, trade, and economic offices.
This is my sister, Stefa, the one that survived the camp with me, and her husband, my brother-in-law, my husband's brother, David, and he survived the war too.
1945.
This was taken about 3 months after we arrived to America. They sent us this picture because they missed us. They were still in Germany. And shortly after that, they came to join us in America.
So this was taken in
1946.
Thank you.
This is me and my firstborn American daughter in New York parading as free people in this wonderful land of ours.
And this was
1946.
Thank you.
This is me in 1950 when I first came to Houston. And it looks to me like I'm conducting some kind of meeting on the telephone. It was in the office where I worked with my husband. I helped him.
Okay.
This is me in 1952 being initiated as a full-fledged American.
Do some detail. Yeah, sure.
These are my daughters, Muriel, M-U-R-I-E-L, and Jeannie, J-E-A, and I-E. And this was done in the early 70s. This is me and my firstborn granddaughter, Michelle, M-I-C-H-E-L-E, born in Houston. She is about 7 here, toothless. This is me and my husband and my firstborn Michelle, my secondborn granddaughter Emily, and my grandson Philip. This was taken also in the 80s. This is me and my husband and my two daughters, Jeannie and Muriel, their two husbands, Marcel and Rich, and my granddaughter, Muriel's daughter, Michelle, in the 70s. This is me and my husband and his brother and my sister and my firstborn grandson, Philip. In the 80s.
Tape number 6, Helen Colin interview, family. Helen, the first thing I'd like you to do is introduce us to all these people that have joined you now.
Okay, this is my daughter Muriel, my firstborn. This is my daughter Jeannie.
Hi.
My second. And this is my firstborn granddaughter, the daughter of Muriel. This is my first grandson in the family, Philip, the son of Muriel. And back of me is my son-in-law, the producer of these two.
The token male of the family.
Over the age of 15.
Okay. People whose names didn't get mentioned, could we introduce yourself starting over here?
I'm Philip, son of Muriel.
And I'm Marcel.
And I'm Michelle.
All right, great. Let's start with the daughters. In fact, Muriel, let's start with you. What was it like for you growing up the child of survivors? How do you think your life was different from other kids?
Well, I think first I was aware initially of being a daughter of immigrants, and it was only later that I began to understand that they weren't simply immigrants, but that they were two people who had survived something very horrible, almost unspeakable, because it wasn't spoken about openly for many, many years, probably almost until my late adolescence. But nevertheless, I found out about their having survived through bits and pieces of information. One anecdote that my mother has reminded us about was that I asked her one day, where are our grandparents? Because I found it very strange that all of the people, all the kids that I knew had grandmothers or grandfathers or both, and uncles and aunts, and we didn't seem to have any family except a very small number, an uncle and an aunt and a couple of cousins. And my mother explained at that point that they were killed, and that they were killed in the war. And gradually I began to understand that this was a very terrible war for my family. And I think it affected me by also creating in me a sense of alienation from my peers, a feeling that I was very different, and that I had a great feeling, I think, growing up of obligation to be more serious, to not be childish and frivolous, and to be serious in my relationship with people, and cynical as well. I didn't feel that I could be naive and fun-loving and carefree. I remember having fantasies as I grew up, often imagining myself in places like a classroom where I would think about what I would do if at that moment Nazis walk in, like the experience that my mother had in her class. You know, where would I go? How would I hide if someone started to open fire? And often looked around in rooms when I entered them, wondering where the exits were. So those types of thoughts aren't, I think, typical of child fantasies.
And I think left a sense of paranoia that certainly robbed me of a feeling of security.
Jeannie, how do you think your parents' experiences affected the kind of parents that they were?
I felt that they continued to be survivors. I felt that they pretty much left World War II and fell into World War III. As our childhood, I can remember my parents always struggling. I was aware of the fact that we were economically not as enhanced as other Jewish people or other people were, and that my parents struggled to make a living and that we had less than other people had. I think that it didn't give them an opportunity to have any chance to relax, to enjoy their kids, to enjoy their family. I don't think they had a chance to love us because they were too wrapped up in trying to still survive. And I remember feeling very unloved and unwanted and unliked by both my mother and my father. And I didn't understand why, and was very angry with both of them for it. And it was very confusing for me as a child because I loved them, but I didn't like them because I didn't know why they didn't give us more time and more love like I'd see in other family homes.
Muriel, do you feel that the kind of parent that you are has been affected by the kind of parenting you had in regards to this experience?
In regard to my parents having had that experience? I'm sure it has. Every person grows to parent based on their own experiences of their own parents. I think, if anything, there's probably that residue of being very serious and not giving. I mean, everything needs to get done, and you know, there's a purpose here, and we've got to work hard. Kind of attitude. Probably what my sister's describing is her lack of perception of feeling loved because there wasn't the playing and the fun and the cuddling and what people would call kicking back got transmitted in my parenting style as well.
How about you, Jeannie? How do you think that your experience has affected the kind of parent that you are?
I think I was very lucky, believe it or not, to have gone through what I went through. I think if I hadn't, I wouldn't have been able to have had the foresight to instill in my child the importance of acceptance of people and their differences, and instill on her how important compromise is in life and respect. It made me appreciate so much more the time I had to spend with my daughter and how much more important it was to listen to her than anything else was, because I didn't ever feel that I was listened to as a kid growing up. they just were always too busy. So I think it helped me to be a better parent because I learned to give love that I felt I hadn't been able to be given as a child from my parents.
Philip, you know what your grandparents have gone through or had gone through before they came to this country. Mm-hmm. How does it make you feel to know what happened to them?
Well, in a way, I was kind of lucky, I think, to have been given grandparents who are excited to, not necessarily excited, but enthusiastic about remembering the Holocaust, and I was very educated upon it, and I felt myself sort of lucky that my grandmother took the time to explain to me what happened so I wouldn't have any preconceived ideas or anything like that. And she gave me a very strong idea of how to remember the Holocaust and never forget. And I consider myself pretty lucky for that. And I mean, I've felt a lot of pain, and I've understood through a fraction of what she went through, and it's very terrifying to me. And I do think in a way it has shaped my life. Believe it or not, I do educate my friends on some of the facts about the Holocaust. And she gave me sort of a sense of responsibility, as I should carry the memory of the Holocaust on to my children and never forget.
Do you have a message for other young people that you've learned from what your family has gone through?
A message would be appreciate your family, be lucky that you have it. I know it's hard. I know families are hard to get along with. I know each family has their dysfunctions. And I know it's difficult, but, you know, you got to count on your lucky stars. You got some family. And look at it that way. Just to have a family. It's my message. Just appreciate your family. Love them for what they are and accept them for who they are. And don't try to make them be what they're not. That's it. And we're trying to achieve that, and we have.
Marcel, you were a hidden child, I understand. So you have personal experience as well as the experience of being married to Muriel. Do you have a message for the people who will watch this from what you've learned from your experience and your family experience?
Well, there are many messages. Obviously, the first one is don't let this happen. There are no reasons why millions of people need to submit themselves to the will of some evil, destructive forces. I think that is the first message, and it's probably the most important message. The other one is my reaction, and I was fortunate enough to survive, obviously, and I was unfortunate enough not to have grown up with a father. And I think I've reacted to that, I hope, by being or trying to be a good father to my children. That's it.
Helen, after what you've just heard, do you have anything you'd like to add?
I would like to say that every day of my existence now is a gift, and every day that I can be with them, I see them, hear them, is a joy, immense joy, and I hope I wouldn't be denied this until I pass on. They'll give me this joy, the privilege to see them, hear them as much as I can now. For that, I'm grateful.
Muriel, do you have any parting words that you'd like to share with us?
Well, it's important to see that this is still emotional. It's not history. It's continuing, that events that occur continue to live
in the people who survive, and in the second generation, and the third generation, and on and on. And the only thing that I think is difficult is to transform what's been an incredibly black period of human civilization into something that can become positive. And we have a profound responsibility to search for solutions to social problems in ways that we've never found before. We have to do that.
Jeannie, do you want to add anything before we close?
Oh, yeah. I'm angry about what happened to our family. I'm angry that I don't have relatives. I'm angry that I never had grandparents. I'm angry that nations knew this happened when it was happening, that people, Jews in this country and in other countries, knew these atrocities were going on, that people didn't stand up and they didn't speak and they didn't demand something from our government and from other governments. And if anything can be learned from this, these atrocities are happening today. They're happening all over the world. They're happening in Iraq. Each one of us can write a letter to the president of the countries where these are happening, to our own president. Make a stand, be a voice, stand up to this in any country that it happens to. And don't let children, innocent little children, be shot down in the streets because of border wars. I've never seen a war that's been won that was worth the lives of so many people dying, so many innocent people. It's not just the Holocaust that I mourn for. I mourn for all the people that are still dying all over the world, the same way our family did. And I just would please ask people to take your voice and write it down and send a letter to your president and speak up against it and make the United Nations listen and put an end to the atrocities in the world.
Thank you.
Thank you. No, I'm grateful. I want to thank you very much for being so kind and patient with us and going through all these hours of work. And I'm grateful for my family for being participants in this event, because this is going to be good for their grandchildren and children. And I'm glad that I could be part of it. And they would at least have a picture of me. I couldn't save one for my mother.
Thank you so much.